Hey, what's up everybody? My name is Brandon Hunter. I'm a board certified pediatrician and ICU doc. In the last video, we talked about signs of dehydration, how to know when your child is moderately or severely dehydrated. In this video, I want to talk about what to do about it. And this is a 20-year-old study, but even back then they knew that there were no clinically important differences between using the strategy of oral rehydration therapy that I'm going to talk about today and IV fluids. So I hope this will be high yield, but I will jump right into it. So to start off, go check out the other video about how to identify mild, moderate, or severe dehydration. I want to be clear that most of what we're talking about today is how to treat mild or moderate dehydration. And the whole logic is that if you can identify mild or moderate dehydration and intervene, then you can actually do something about it before it gets to severe, where you will need IV fluids. The only other caveat that I want to make is that we're talking about kids over 6 months old. So under 6 months of age, a lot of this likely still applies, but it really needs to be individualized and you need to talk to your pediatrician about it. And they really just have to keep a close eye on those kids because they can go from 0 to 100 really fast and get very dehydrated very quickly. So to start off, when we talk about oral rehydration therapy, first of all, what should we rehydrate with? The evidence supports for most children that Pedialyte is a great option, and let's talk about why. So the basic idea is that Pedialyte has a nice balance of salt, which is sodium and chloride essentially, but sodium primarily, and glucose or sugar. There's this transporter in your intestines that pulls sugar and sodium in at the same time. And when those two molecules come in, it drags water with it. So the evidence suggests that you can hydrate much more effectively, get much more water in if you use that mechanism where you have similar amounts of sugar and salt to encourage your body to absorb that water. Here's just a list of the common ingredients. So up top, carbohydrate, you can just think of as sugar. Sodium, I'll just say salt, but sodium chloride. And let's look at Pedialyte up top. Units don't really matter, but there's 25, let's say, of sugar and 45 of sodium. When we look down below at the common things that get used around the house to rehydrate, apple juice, for example, has like 4 times or more the amount of sugar, but essentially no sodium. Chicken broth, on the other hand, has almost all sodium, but no sugar. And then there are certain things like Gatorade that are actually a little bit closer. So Gatorade's not too far off from the amount of sugar that you would want, but a little bit low in sodium. So in looking at these numbers, again, under 6 months old, discuss with a pediatrician. Usually the recommendation is to continue with breast milk or formula feeding, whatever you've been doing. But 6 months to a year, you can either use breast milk or formula, or if the baby's vomiting with that, switch to Pedialyte. For children older than a year, Pedialyte is definitely recommended, but if you wanted to use half diluted apple juice, like we said, that'll get that sugar into a normal range, or a sports drink like Gatorade, that would be reasonable as well. And again, half diluted just means one part water, one part apple juice. Critical point I want to make here. If you have an infant under 1 year of age, do not give water. And if you're making the formula, don't try to hydrate them more by putting extra water into the mix. This has the potential to really hurt them. The basic idea is that if you don't have enough sodium coming into the baby's body and you just have it absorbing a bunch of water, eventually the blood level of sodium drops very low. And this means that water will escape into tissues and cause swelling. And the dreaded complication that we fear is what's called cerebral edema. The left side is a brain that essentially looks normal. It's got these grooves in it that we call sulci, and you expect to see those. On the right is a brain with cerebral edema. We actually don't see any of those lines anymore. And this can be a dreaded result of giving too much water to young infants. Okay, so what is oral rehydration therapy? These are the instructions and pretty much everything you need to know. These are from the Children's Hospital of Philadelphia guidelines, but I will just say that what you're basically trying to do is to fluid replete, or to replenish the amount of fluid that has been lost, by going slow and very steady. So you essentially give a small amount of liquid by mouth every 5 minutes for 2 to 4 hours. Now, yes, that is painful and gonna be hard, but the whole idea is that if you can do it slowly but surely like that, then the stomach will never get so full that it makes the child throw up and you lose all your gains, but it will essentially be the equivalent of what we would give them by IV if they came to the hospital. So let's look through point by point. So the first, oral rehydration therapy is a treatment for dehydrated patients. Great. But you give a small amount of liquid, either by a syringe or a small cup or a spoon, every 5 minutes, and in this case, sustained for 3 to 4 hours. Pedialyte, as we talked about before, is the best fluid of choice for children under 1 year of age. For older children, if you want to use Gatorade or half apple juice and half water, we can substitute that. The next point that's made is that, yeah, so it might be that your child actually wants more than what you're giving every 5 minutes. That can be okay. So you can continue breastfeeding or formula feeding in between. But in general, if the child's been throwing up a lot, it's recommended that you really stick to this small amount, because sometimes children think they want more, they take it in, and then they throw it up, and you've lost all the progress you made over those last, you know, number of minutes or hour. And then the final thing to know is at the beginning, it might be that the child refuses fluid, but it usually gets better the longer you go on. month, so just stick with it if you can. This is an easy reference for the amount of fluid that you would want to give every 5 minutes, so 10, 15, and 30 mLs based on the 6 to 12 month age group, 1 to 2 years, or over 2 years. And again, this has the other references for it, so in teaspoons and ounces to make it easier for you. Okay, so I did want to pause just real quick just to tell you how awesome it is what you're doing if you're able to do this for your child. So if you come to the ER and the child is severely dehydrated and we say, oh man, we have to give a fluid bolus to replenish them, to replete them, we basically give what's called a 20 ml per kilo fluid bolus, or that's the amount of fluid that we give. I just want to make the point that with the oral rehydration therapy, if you follow what we talked about, giving that basically it's 1 ml per kilo every 5 minutes, you're giving half of the fluid bolus we would be giving them every hour. And so if you do this for 2 hours, you've given a full fluid bolus that we would give in the ER. And if you do it for 4 hours, you've basically given two. And so the whole point of this, it's called the replenish phase, but you're trying to mimic what we would do in the ER, but just get ahead of it where you don't have to have your child stuck. You don't have to get exposed to IV fluids, other kids in the ER, long wait times, and all those other things. So you get through the replenishing phase, you do the every 5 minutes for 2 to 4 hours, the child's starting to look better, you're feeling better. Well, then it's time to just restart a regular age-appropriate diet. So if that was breastfeeding, then continue breastfeeding or formula therapy. And then in this case, you wanna restrict fruit juices and carbonated beverages. The juices, I'll just make the point, because I meant to say it earlier, but I didn't. If you have too much sugar in a drink and it's not getting absorbed by the intestine, so before, say you're just giving full-strength apple juice, there's a concern that if that glucose gets stuck in the intestines or the gut, it's actually gonna pull water with it and it can make the diarrhea worse. So it's best to avoid those if you can. Another thing that is very important with oral rehydration therapy is the use of antiemetics or Zofran. So many hospitals will have this as a part of their pathway where, hey, a child comes in, we're gonna do oral rehydration therapy and we're gonna give a dose of Zofran upfront to help reduce the amount of emesis or vomit that they're having. You might hear online or in the news that Zofran can affect the heart and affect how it beats. And that's true. So there's something called the QT interval, which is essentially a part of how the heart is conducting electricity. And if you give a lot of Zofran, this can actually widen that interval. And in very rare cases, it can cause arrhythmia or serious events. I'll just say there have been studies about this, about using Zofran in the outpatient setting and in otherwise healthy children who don't have what we call cardiomyopathy. They don't have cardiac disease, or they don't have an undiagnosed problem with the electrical conduction system of their heart. It's usually tolerated quite well. But that's definitely a conversation between the pediatrician and parent about what they're comfortable prescribing in the outpatient setting. I will say in the intensive care unit, we use a lot of Zofran and on patients who have long QT intervals, and I've at least never, knock on wood, never seen it result in a bad outcome, even in these very medically complex children. And then I will just show one study just about the effectiveness of it. Their main point was actually looking at cost effectiveness. This was a study in the UK, but it did show that a single dose of oral Zofran, or ondansetron in how they refer to it here, it reduced the amount of children who had continued vomiting from 43% down to 20%. So about half the kids responded, which is pretty great. But once you've gotten through the oral rehydration therapy, the replenishing phase, then resuming an age-appropriate diet makes sense. Already talked about avoiding sugary or caffeinated beverages, but here are just some examples of things that you could try for your child to see if it helps. Other things to avoid would be caffeine. We already talked about sugary foods, but also very greasy foods might upset children's stomachs. And then just to end with things not to do, so it might make sense if your child has vomiting and diarrhea that you would want to give them Imodium, or a medicine that stops diarrhea. In pediatrics, we strongly recommend against this. It's okay for adults to take it, but there's some data that it can kind of slow down the transit time for kids that can lead to either ileus, which just means very slow gut motility, which can be a problem, or even things like, we call it toxic megacolon, but you can actually have very, very severe bad things happen when you take Imodium, so we really recommend against it, especially in children less than 3 years of age. Okay, so the whole point of this video is to empower parents when there is either just the start of dehydration, mild dehydration, to try to intervene with this therapy to reduce the need to go to the doctor or the ER. But let's just go over things that you really should not mess around. So any of the signs of moderate or severe dehydration that we reviewed in the other video, especially feeling very tired, thirsty, dizzy, confused, definitely want to seek emergency care in that case. If the vomiting or diarrhea is lasting longer than just a couple days, that might indicate that something else is going on rather than just a routine viral gastroenteritis. If there's any blood in vomit, in diarrhea, or really severe belly pain, would also want to go. If you see dark green emesis, rhinosis, which is a bilious color, would want to go, and then not able to tolerate anything for a few hours, or if there's no urine output or decreased urine output for a period of time, then really want to be evaluated. Okay, so I close all my videos by saying this is not medical advice, this is medical education, but I really do hope it's helpful. And the whole point here is that we want to educate parents to be able to detect dehydration and then act on it to prevent bad outcomes. I didn't say this, but you know, every winter there are children who get admitted to the intensive care unit with severe dehydration. Their sodium is through the roof, their kidneys are hurt. We have to rehydrate them over several days. And every one of those, I always kind of have this feeling of like, this could have been avoided if maybe parents knew what to look for, get to care sooner, or start that oral rehydration therapy at home. So I hope this information was helpful. If you stuck with me to this point and you want to like or subscribe, that'd be amazing. And more than that, as always, I ask for comments. So any comments, questions about this video, or suggestions for future ones would be super appreciated. All right, thanks so much.